I'm Judy Larson, director of the Westmont Ridley Tree Museum of Art, and it's a pleasure to welcome you to our artist talk for, I think, Tug, which features the collaborative work of Dane Goodman and Keith Puccinelli. This exhibition came about 2 years ago when I was invited to their studio to see their some collaborative prints that they were working on. And from there we went, it was a great discussion. They were fascinating prints. From there, Jane Deering exhibited them in her gallery and came and talked to me and said, like, someone should buy the whole series. And I thought, well, it's probably going to be a bigger museum than the Westmont Ridley Tree. And she said, no, it should be the Westmont Ridley Tree Museum of Art. And we happened to have some funds, not quite enough. And Jane was good enough to brainstorm with me. And maybe several of you actually helped match the gift I had. They came into the collection, and I sort of teasingly said to Dane and Keith, well, we'll have to wait a little while until we show them. Wouldn't it be cool if we could exhibit them in a couple of years with even more material? And of course, artists never miss the opportunity for an exhibit. But I knew it would be a fun and good exhibit. And if you've seen it, you know that's true. If you're going to see it afterwards, the museum will be open. We need to be out of here by 7:30. So there are refreshments out on the patio, and we'll have the museum open, and we'll continue the discussion up in the gallery, which of course is the best place to see art anyway. There are some thank yous that I want to do. We had several wonderful sponsors step forward to help us put this exhibit on, but I want to single out four people who were lead sponsors, and that would be Michael and Nancy Gifford, Alice Gillaroo, and Susan Jorgensen, and Clay Tedeschi. I think I got them all there. Thank you so much, and for the rest of you who came forward to help, it was very much appreciated. I want to thank Myopia, who helped us publish this wonderful catalog, which will be available upstairs for sale. They did a wonderful job, and they're always a pleasure to work with. I want to thank my staff, including Rachel Urbano, who is head of outreach and education, and Chris Rupp, collections manager. Both of them put together the details of tonight's lecture, talk, and also the Westmont Art Council, who are always so supportive of everything we do at the museum. Tonight they helped with the refreshment, so thank you to them. I probably don't need much of an introduction for Keith and Dane, because I bet you know them quite well. I think that Dane Goodman and Marie Sheff were two of the first artists I met when I came to Santa Barbara almost 8 years ago now, and was invited over to their house. I met Keith Puccinelli and his wife Fran a little bit later. I think it was Dane, of course, was the director at the Atkinson Gallery. He's now retired, and he did the first exhibition of Keith Puccinelli in Santa Barbara, and that was I knew his work. That's the first time I saw an exhibition, and just sort of knocked me over. also, both Dane and Keith are extraordinary art collectors in their own right, and we borrowed folk art pieces from both of these artists for the folk art show we did, so there was a good connection to both of these artists. But this idea of a collaborative effort was, I thought, quite unique. There aren't too many artists that they say they collaborate, but to really be drawing on each other's works, I think, is something quite unique. Dane Goodman got his start in life out in Illinois, and he went to undergraduate to Western Illinois University, and then graduate work in art at Illinois State University, finishing up at Cal State University in Sacramento. And it was the path for Keith that he's a San Jose grew up in San Jose, so he went to San Jose State, where he majored in art. Keith went on to start a very successful marketing and graphic design firm here in Santa Barbara. And Dane, of course, was first with the Santa Barbara Museum of Art as an art handler and designing exhibitions and sort of working all those behind-the-scenes jobs, and then eventually became director of the Atkinson Gallery, where he retired 2 years ago, just in time to start working on the exhibit that you will enjoy after the lecture. They are represented in collections around Santa Barbara in Southern California, even around the nation, in both museum collections and private collections. And of course, they represented both of them as individuals in the Westmont Ridley Tree Museum of Art, and now we have 110 prints from the portfolio, the trace drawings that you'll see in the exhibition. We had a lot of fun working with these guys. Their work is based in humor, but it's not your ha-ha kind of humor. It can be dark. It can be stinging. Their subject matter is drawn right from the headlines and current events, and I think they are at times really asking us to deal with some tough issues and to really be mindful and thoughtful of the world around us, what's going on. They make us think, and to me, that's what art should do. So I give you Dane Goodman and Keith Puccinelli.
This part, and I forgot about the head. I'm done. What is it?
If you don't know who Erica Huff is, go online and find out about Erica Huff. She's here tonight someplace. She makes fabulous furniture, so we're borrowing for the show. So thank you. Thank you, Erica.
Now what?
Everything's digital. All done digitally.
Digit.
So what are we got here.
So, yeah, we want to thank Judy and the staff and everybody from Westmont who's helped us put this show on, and all of you for coming tonight, and the feedback and all that.
And we would especially thank Myopia. Are James Van Arsdale and Kimberly Hahn here tonight? I don't know if they are. I can't see. But anyway, they designed this fantastic catalog. I really encourage you to take a look at it. We appreciate that. And Brad Allitt, Wayne McCall did the photography. I don't know if Debbie Murphy is here, but Debbie Murphy is the one that allowed us to work in this enormous space out in the foothills of Carpinteria to make the big boat. And if we hadn't had that, there wouldn't be a boat. So we really appreciate that. And then, of course, Marie and Fran, our wives, we can't do it without them. And then the last person is Christopher Miles. Christopher Miles is a Los Angeles artist and critic who wrote the essay. And I would encourage you to read the essay because it's pretty amazing what he did in such a short period of time with us. He kind of latched onto, I think, some pretty great stuff. So have we forgotten anybody?
Our dog.
Yeah, let's forget our dog. They go everywhere with
them. This is Mr. Rennan. Mr. Rennan dog. Right?
Right. And yeah. And whenever we're at a loss of what to do, you can always draw a wiener dog. That's our motto. You can always draw a wiener dog.
You know, I want to apologize. Some of you know me and you know my voice is kind of messed up. And for those who don't know me, I'll just say my voice is kind of messed up. So that's good luck to all of you. That's all I can say.
The question mark is, you can ask us questions anytime. You can save them till last, but we would really like it if we...
We can't see it, so yeah. Shout it out or do whatever you can to get our attention.
We noticed on the card, and we're very thankful for, it says that this is not a lecture. It says it's a talk, because a lecture is supposed to...
No lectures.
Yeah, because a lecture is supposed to be an educational talk. So that's not going to happen. And it's supposed to be a long, serious speech, especially one given as a scolding or reprimand. We could do that. Yeah,
I know you can.
But a talk actually means a conversation or a discussion. So that's what we're going to do tonight. Keith and I are going to talk a bit. We're going to show you a few slides.
Ask us questions. And we may call on you, you know, and ask you to speak and ask them.
Yeah.
And so.
Okay. So we got the game plan. Okay.
So what's the first question?
Yeah, what was that question? See, well, I always wanted to start a talk. We just come out and just stand there. Keith and I were threatening, and we're just going to stand there and say, just stand there until there was a question. That's good. The question was, can everybody hear when she says that? The question is, how do we, this whole idea of collaboration. Do you want me to tell the story?
I'm not sure I like that question. Maybe it's a better one. Go ahead. Sorry.
I think probably 7 years ago, Keith and I were both in an exhibition at Sylvie White's gallery in Ventura. And I had done some trace monotypes, and they were in the exhibition. And Keith seemed to really like them, and we were talking about them. He said, how did you make those? And I said, well, come over to the studio and I'll show you. I'd come over and do that. And so maybe a day or two before he was supposed to come over, he sent me an email and said, well, what do you think about the idea of collaborating? That was an interesting...
No, wait a minute.
This is the way it's going to be all night long.
I had collaborated with somebody before, and artistically it turned out successfully, but interpersonally, it was a disaster. So, you know, I've been hesitant about this idea, but I kind of had in my mind that I wanted to collaborate. And actually, I sent out a group email to about 25 people, and you were on it.
I was the only one that replied.
And he was the only one who replied, so here we are.
I always wanted to know.
I forgot about that.
I always wanted to know about that. That's really good. So Keith came over, and I showed him the basic technique, which if we go up into the gallery, I can talk about in person. Keith and I can show you that. And it was immediately, it's a drawer's medium doing a trace monotype. And so we did like one or two, and it was totally obvious that he got it, that we got it. So Keith had been drawing this clown figure for a long time, and I'd been doing some of the snowman thing. So I think it was kind of a general thought, well, I don't know what we're going to do, but at least it could be like this conversation between...
cartoon, you know, one person talking to the other.
Yeah, I think that was kind of it. But we let that go after about 10 prints because there were other things we wanted to do. So that was it. We did those about 8 sessions. And
we were collaborating just for me to learn, and it was very enjoyable, and not to make an art show or have a show. It was just doing this on a Saturday, and so we did it again, and we did it again, and we did it again, and it was really, really a lot of fun.
Yeah, so many people may have heard me say this, but my daughter called them our play dates. And they were for a good time. So the music you heard back when we were backstage and when we were coming out, that was on constantly the whole time. Music has always been a big part of both of our lives growing up. We grew up in different places, but sort of the same time frame, and listening to similar music. In particular, you know, because I'm from the Midwest and Chicago area, I'm a huge blues fan, and Keith is a huge blues fan. So it was great getting together and just passing forth a lot of songs.
And it was kind of the birth of that bluesy rock and roll era, and blues was underlining all of that, and yeah.
And you were a bouncer at that club for a while, right?
For one night.
Tell them how you did that.
I worked at this restaurant, and it was kind of a surf and turf kind of a restaurant up in San Jose. And at night, we would have rock and roll bands. And in fact, on Thursday nights, we did all the big acts that were coming to the Bay Area, to the Fillmore West or whatever, and they'd stop by at the Bodega Club and play. And we had some big names, from Bob Stage to Albert Ting to Butterfield Blues Band, you know, everybody, Doobie Brothers. And one night, well, like I said, it was surf and turf for dinner, and then after hours, it was a club, and a lot of bikers used to come to the club, and there'd be fights and all that crap. And so one night they were short of a doorman. So I've been working out like I do now. And so I put like 2 sweatshirts on and a blue jeans jacket. And I was kind of like all bulky. And I remember I had to kind of guard the side. It was in an old tannery warehouse, and it had sliding doors, and so this guy comes through the door. I'm guarding, you know, I'm supposed to see this biker out of the damn nightclub, and I said, I sent him into the need to squad right in. I said, okay, no problem. And I was never a bouncer after that. So yeah. Why did I say this? Why did I talk about
I ask you. This is how our conversations go. So does that sort of get the gist of, like, at least how we started doing this? I mean, Keith and I had known one another's work for a long time in Santa Barbara and were friendly. But pretty much since that point, especially during this process, you know, it's pretty much like 9-to-5 job, and we're in contact all the time, sending one another ideas or pictures of cool cars and, you know, that kind of stuff. Kind of a guy's thing, you know, so. So let's see what's up here.
Okay.
Do you all know who Thornton Dial is? Sort of a outsider artist.
Self-taught.
This is his comment about talking. It is an odd thing. We worked for 2 years for that show up there. We did all the stuff. We purposely asked Judy if we could have no label copy in that show. So it was a visual experience. And now we have to talk about it.
Also, Anton Chekhov, check that out, said, quote, the role of an artist is to ask questions, not answer them.
So
we're not going to talk anymore. But, you know, the price was right, so.
But that always is the thing. I think when the first, was it Yvonne Rainer, the dancer, when they were first giving out NEA grants to artists, artists had to fill out this application, and she said, I'm a dancer, I'm not a writer, I want the grant, and they gave it to her. I think it was something to that effect. I thought that was great. But we're on an educational campus, we're going to do our best here. So, let's see. Oh, yeah. That dog, every time. So, you see certain imagery stay with us all of our lives. Keith, what was this?
Well, this is my nightlight as a child. I'm not sure what my parents were thinking, but it was kind of weird. I still have it. Every night. No, I don't.
That's what he looked at. So, this is a drawing of mine from when I just had turned 5. I was born in August, I turned 5.
And you can kind of looks like that drawing over there.
And you see the advancement that I've made in my work over the years. I found this recently in Family Materials, and I had forgotten it. And it's about this big. And I really love this drawing. It's better than what I do now. And I'll tell you why I think so. First of all, there's three people. Could have been my brother and sister at the time. I like the colors. I like the way their hands intertwine. And I really like it because they're standing in sunshine. You know, it's like snowman, sunshine. I think I'm California dreaming. We might be smoking medicinal something or other. I'm not sure. But Keith and I are enormous fans of outsider art, folk art. And part of that is because of the freshness of the work. It's not labored. It's kind of like really raw, and it just comes out naturally. It's not educated. It just is what it is. So, I kind of like this drawing. So that's why I showed it to you.
I mean, went to school for years in the college and all that to try and forget how to draw like that. And then since then, we've been trying to figure out how to draw like that. Whoa.
Look at the hair in this picture.
Is that Donald Trump over there?
Donald Trump over there.
What's that?
I'm not going to say who this is, but it's not in Illinois. That's all I'm going to say.
San Jose.
Yeah. So this is another version of hair. This is the hair face. This is a drawing of Keith.
Because you studied with the Harry Who.
Yes, I studied with Jim Nutt, the Harry Who. But this is Keith's drawing. So, I mean, it's interesting Keith brings up Jim Nutt at the Harry Who. That was a group out of Chicago. Jim Nutt, Roger Brown, not Roger Brown, Gladys Nilsson, Carl Worsham, that came on strong in the late 60s, and now their impact is still being felt. But Jim Nutt, Gladys Nilsson, and Carl Worsham came and taught at Sac State. That was one of the major reasons I wanted to go out there. And Keith was down in the Bay Area, and what was going on in the late 60s and the 70s was this thing called funk. Area of funk. I know Dan Connolly was here would know about this. All these artists were working in a particular vein, and it was really out of the mainstream. You know, New York wasn't particularly interested in this work, and now it's being shown everywhere. Jim Nutt's paintings sell for $300,000 and stuff.
They influenced a lot of people, and a lot of people in the Bay Area, West Coast, including me and Dan and all that. And, you know, Dan is from Illinois. And so she seems to be fond of Abraham Lincoln.
I actually grew up in Lincoln, Illinois, which was
at the same time as Abraham Lincoln. So anyway, I kind of...
So when I was in Lincoln, this is what I looked like. This is about seventh grade. Keith was telling me today that he really wanted to be able to wear his hair like that. We were saying at that time, right, you pretty much could wear your hair like this, or the other one was called flat top with...
Fenders.
Flat top with fenders, it's kind of...
Bad.
But, so we're going to show you this, but like, this is how things become fodder for material. I have a church story, this is apropos, that goes with my hair. About this time, was going to Sunday school, and of course the real reason I wanted to go to Sunday school was because I think there were some pretty attractive girls in the class. And so, of course, but I was waking up late, mom's, get up. So I get up, and like, do whatever, water my hair. At that time, we to make your hair like that, we put this, what would now be called a product. It was called Brill Cream, if that rings a bell for anybody.
A little dab of duty, huh?
There you go, a little red and white and blue tube. So I put up my hair, run out, go to Sunday school, sitting in the classroom.
I believe that's what Nathan Hayden still uses over there.
Nathan Hayden, to keep that hair up like that. Yeah, I think he does. So anyway, you're so concerned about the way you look or like making the impression, and my friend in the class is doing this to me. Hey, Goodman. He's like, what's with your hair? I'm like, no, it's my hair. It's like, what's with your hair? I'm like, come on, shut up. He said, your hair, it's got all this dandruff in it. Oh no, I'm shuddering, it's dandruff. I said, no, I just can't. And so, of course, I slyly do this kind of a thing. I'm going, what is this? And so the longer I'm sitting there, it was the Crest toothpaste that was drying in my hair, and there's huge hunks of Crest toothpaste. The tube was the same color. I made a real impression with those girls in the class that day.
Moving on to
old age and illness.
And we're going to spend the rest of the evening talking about being old and our ailments. You don't mind, do you? Go ahead. During this time period of working on this exhibition, we kind of, from time to time, would wonder if we would actually be alive by the time the show opened, being kind of the elderly. And lots of things occurred. People died that we knew, and very sad. We got sick, other people got sick. I had a lung infection, and my left lung was filled up with a kind of a bacteria stew or something. I'm not sure what it was, but it was juicy. And so I had to have a stent or a needle stuck in my lung, which was not that great. And then I had to carry this bag around for 6 weeks, or I don't know, it was like forever, waiting for my lung to drain out into the bag. And I emptied the bag, put it back in, and so, I mean, meanwhile, I'm drawing clowns and working on the project. So stuff happens when you get older that...
I mean, especially with Keith's work and some of the work that's upstairs. I mean, I had some friends from Sacramento that came down for the opening who've known me since graduate school, so like 40 years ago, and they've known my work. And then they were with my studio the next day, and one of them was dancing around the issue and said, I don't remember your work being so dark. And of course I had someone else, and I don't know if she's here, but Laura Krifka, the wonderful painter, wrote me and said, I was surprised by the darkness of the work, and I really liked it. So I don't think that Keith and I think about necessarily, let's make the work dark. It's more like this is a matter of fact. This is just part of our whole experience, because at the same time, this is me. I had an operation on my foot over here, you see with the stitches. And at the same time, I had these kind of bump things on my elbows. And I thought, hey, let's get them all done at the same time. Really smart, right? You can't do anything like this. And then they had to do something else to me. They couldn't put the needle in my arm, so they put it in my foot. So this is me. So I'm telling Keith about this, and so Keith does. So this is Keith's drawing of me. Like, you know, this is. So this happens every day, this kind of stuff. And then there's all these other things that just happen in the news. It's just wonderful fodder. This is his keys.
Well, now, this is during the time in which we are making stuff and coming up with ideas for the exhibition upstairs. And so I made this drawing and later a model of this thing I heard about in the mail. I mean, on the radio. No, it was a radio. So, in Guam, the U.S. territory, Guam, they have these tree snakes that are not indigenous, but they're killing everything that lives there. I mean, wiping out vegetation, other animals, everything. So, they figured out how to kill the tree snakes without killing anything else. And the way they did it was they dropped rodents that were dead and had a Tylenol inside of them. And then the snakes would eat the rodent, but the Tylenol would kill them, but it wouldn't kill anybody else. So I thought, this is not possible, but it was. It was in the surreal deal, and so I was just flabbergasted.
And he made a really great sculpture of this piece. So, students, if you don't have any ideas, just open the newspaper. I mean, seriously, it's just there. It's
or like, call me up or call Dane, or tell you something.
Yeah, because walk down the street, Happy Valentine's Day in Goleta. It's like, this is for sale. It was like, oh, this is great. And then, of course, in one of the trips to the hospital, something to do, I'm sitting outside waiting for something, and then this goes by. She is so happy, isn't she? Look at her. She's just like, look what I have. And I'm as fast as I can get my iPhone out to take a picture of this thing. It's like, this is fantastic. This is happening every day all around us. All you have to do is pay attention and have your camera ready.
Or follow us around.
Yeah. It's like, isn't this great? So, let's see. I think this is it. So, if you notice the those shapes in there, and this is a piece of sculpture that's about this big.
Well, this kind of reminds me of the previous slide. Yeah. No, kind of. No.
And it's called Flesh Boat. And it's so grotesque. It's something I made. And, of course, it's what I gave Keith for his birthday, because he's the only one who would really like this thing. I mean, he's repulsed by it, but he likes it.
And it's like that fleshy stuff that Nathan's doing. I don't know why I see pictures of it on Facebook, but it's just grotesque. God.
So this is...
Why are we talking about all this?
We're moving past it. We're dealing with it.
Ask us a question.
Yeah. So this is another drawing I found when I found that snowman drawing, which I love. And I don't know if it's mine or it's my youngest brother, Ty. I'm not sure, but I'm really crazy about this drawing. Because look at those little faces up there, you know. And are they fishing? Are those oars? What are they? But there's something really terrific about that. And one thing about this is that during most of my life, you know, sometimes I was an abstract artist, but it was a short period. Both Keith and I have always drawn vehicles. Boys do this a lot. I remember sitting in class and drawing on those little pink pearl erasers. You draw the wheels on them and make them into dragsters. Always drawing these
vehicles. I haven't tried that.
Oh, yeah. They're perfect. They look like they're moving. So like, here's a drawing. By the way, everything we're showing you are things that are not in the show. We're not showing you anything that's in the show. This is just some of the stuff we did.
That's up there.
Yeah. So you know, these are like ideas. Hey, Keith, what about a boat that has a water tower in it? I mean, that's kind of ridiculous because it's surrounded by water, right?
That's pretty ridiculous, I said. Yeah. Yes. And what about having a tennis on top of a water tower?
Yeah.
Sort of a water retention system.
And this whole thing with rafts, I've been drawing these kind of rafts because I'm from Illinois, the whole Mark Twain thing, up and down, you know, the Mississippi thing.
And, you know, why do people want to take the boat somewhere? Why do they do that? I mean, maybe they're oppressed, life is terrible, and they want to get away, or maybe they want to discover, have an adventure. I mean, it's dangerous. It's a dangerous, stupid thing to do, is to go out on a big old body of water in a couple of 2x4s with some varnish on it. But
as we know in those studies, when they do all those political studies, they talk about the blue states and red states. A lot of the blue states are around bodies of water. And it's my theory is because there's so much movement coming and going, you know, immigrants, people flowing through, that people get a little more used to like transitional things.
I heard Obama was an immigrant.
Oh, yeah, he's definitely an immigrant.
Africa.
Yeah, definitely.
I heard that.
Yeah. Muslim, too, yeah. We'll have to do a drawing about that, yeah.
Okay.
We're not including any Donald Trump imagery, but we might.
But we could.
Yeah, we could. So we're talking about, Keith and I are talking about, you know, we need in the show maybe some sort of a building, institution, and we're sending things, so Keith sends this wonderful little, whatever it is, some sort of an institution.
Yeah, I think of it as an institution. I've seen anything from a factory to a warehouse to a tannery to a mental hospital or a prison or any of those kinds of things where there's been kind of plain, gray, multi-story buildings and a smokestack coming out of it. And so I sent this drawing.
Yeah, and at the first of the year, Marie and I went up to San Francisco to go to Alcatraz to visit some of my relatives. But didn't you see the Ai Weiwei
show? Some of my relatives?
To visit the Ai Weiwei show. And Keith and I have been talking about this image, and we need to do something. And as we're coming to the island and got on the island, there was. And I'm totally excited about this. And I'm shooting pictures, all kinds of pictures around this. And then I came home, and I'm sending Keith pictures home. And I came home, and then if you go up to the show, Keith, I'd already made the factory. We're completely on the same wavelength at the same moment, making the same thing. Yeah. And of course, for us, the factory is also the workplace. If you see upstairs in the show, you'll see our aprons hanging next to the factory. And it's sitting on a table that was my grandmother's craft table. And if you look closely, you'll see this stencil of a ruler stenciled on there that either she did or my grandfather did. And she was crucial for me in reason being an artist. Yeah.
Do we have a picture of that?
I think we said we weren't going to show anything
that was
in the show. So we're just going to show some other things. Not nonsensical
things that were considered to be maybe in the show, but then they were ultimately rejected.
Like an odd thing, if you saw a raft with a brick fireplace on it, what is that? Why is it? Why is it out there? I did this drawing, so the fireplace would go all the way up to the ceiling, and be up the ceiling. So.
You can't believe the number of drawings we did of fireplaces. Fireplaces. They didn't do anything. There it is again.
We made a model of the gallery before we really got very far into the show, so we really worked everything out. And these are some other kind of things. But I want to ask you just to pay attention a little bit to the white scrim cutout over there, because we're going to talk about it in a minute. That's the big window in the gallery.
You know, sometimes they wear socks.
Yeah.
in the winter.
And this is messing around with scale, just altering a scale. Yeah. Why don't you tell me this is good.
This is one of the first kind of drawings that we were talking about, kind of collections of items, clothing and bread over here and whatnot, spoons, pajamas. Ultimately, we did pajamas. But I had heard a story about, I think it was a priest, somebody in Korea who, the prisoners in Korea, North Korea, I kind of forgot the story, but he would gather blankets out of wool and he would make socks for the prisoners' feet because it was terribly cold there. And I just was kind of touched by that. And so I was thinking about maybe making a bunch of socks out of old blankets and whatnot. And I didn't do that. I made a couple of socks, but we moved on from there. Mm.
But I made this sock tree, you know, with inner tubes around the base. Some of you seen my work over the years. I've used the image of tree. I've made sculptures from our Christmas trees. All these things that we're showing you, all these images are everyday images. There's nothing exotic. We would like to think that anybody can look at our work and at least get the imagery. We're not so sure about the meaning ourselves, but that at least it's approachable to everyone. It's kind of a democratic approach to that and to the materials that we use.
It's kind of pre-computer age imagery and techniques and technology. I noticed we don't have a lot of iPhone drawings and whatnot, but...
But we do them. We do iPad drawings.
We will.
Trying to come up with a name for the show, and one of the, of course, it ended up being Tug. And well, how do you illustrate what that is? And so particular images would come up, like this is drawing a piece, you know, like a tire swing. And I'm trying to remember.
Kind of tugging back and forth.
And this was one of mine, you know, just like, okay.
Because he was back in the Midwest where it snowed.
Yeah, we actually had that kind of thing. So for us, it's kind of a sweet image, but for somebody else, it might not be a sweet image. It might, you know, just something hanging from a rope is pretty tough stuff.
And well, I agree, yeah.
Yeah, and so we kind of backed off on that little one because...
We were afraid that it would conjure up lynching, and I mean, I'm okay if it conjures up lynching if I wanted to conjure up lynching, but we didn't want it to do that, so... We kind of backed off from that.
And there we go, down the road. There we go.
And here's another vehicle, a kind of a boat, if you will, but it's a tar. Yeah. They used to call big old tars, used to be called boats, you know, like Bonnevilles and Tupidevilles and who knows what. Yeah. And so there we are, cruising.
And this is another version of mine where there becomes a pajama a tree, it's floating on with inner tubes, and then it's being towed by this, in this case, a real tugboat. The boat upstairs is not a tugboat, it's just a boat. This is a tugboat. So, yeah.
But, you know, we kind of thought it was a tugboat for a while. But now we've totally freaking denied it.
Yeah.
No way.
Also had this idea of making woodcut prints of life-size pajamas and then making a tree shape. So, I hope you're getting the sense that we made a lot of work that didn't get in the show. Some, for whatever reason, some because it wasn't up to snuff, but some of them we just like, it's just not quite right for this show.
I have probably a dozen different journals that are filled up with drawings and ideas and writings for this exhibit.
If you look at the prints in the hallway.
As does Dan.
Yeah, we have a lot of stuff. You'll find there's a little image about this big of a little pair of pajamas, a onesie.
Are you going to show that right now?
No, I was just going to say okay. That this is because that's a long story. That's a long story. So anyway, So one of the things we were thinking about when we started this whole thing, well, what are we going to do out here at Westmont? I'd been thinking about, you know, hunger in Santa Barbara, that children would go hungry in this county. It's unbelievable to me. So anyway, I'd drawn this sweet little pajamas and put this, you know, bowl of food on it. But Keith had seen this guy.
John, which has nothing to do with pajamas.
Well, it has something to do with food, I thought.
Food. We were going to work on carpenteria at the studio that we were able to use and build the boat, which is too big for our studios. And there's agriculture out in carpenteria, and there was a guy that was sitting on a stack of bots, and he was doing something. I couldn't tell what he was doing, but I imagined him peeling potatoes. And potatoes had been thought about previously and had been shown in the trace prints. And so we kind of played around with the potato idea. And ultimately, it did show up on the wall, but not this one.
But then Keith also made a bunch of potatoes.
Yeah, because that's what I do. I make art and just throw it away.
Yeah. So for students here, it's like everything we do in the show is really economical. And most everything that's in the show could literally just be made on your kitchen table. Like, Keith, I think you made this by like wadding up paper and then tape.
Wadding it up, taping it up, slapping on some paint, sticking in a stitch, slapping on more tape. It's going to last. These are going to last a lifetime.
So, I mean, that brings up a really good point because we've been asked that question, but we ask it amongst ourselves. A lot of that stuff in there is not done on the best materials. Some of it is done on archival material, but most of it's not. I mean, the boat is made with, it's a wood structure, but it's made with plastic, cellophane, and duct tape. Lifespan, pretty short in that. So at some point, it may be because we're not gonna talk a lot about age, but because we're older, a lot less concerned about longevity. I mean,
we just needed to stay together and not fall apart for another month, you know, and then the show's over, but it's okay.
Yeah. So those are questions. My thing is like, let's back off here and say, well, why did you start making art in the first place? What was that impulse about? What if there weren't any galleries? Would you still be making art? What if there weren't any opportunities to show your work? Would you still be making art? I believe it's a natural impulse by everybody to do these things. It sort of gets beaten out of you at about 11 years old in school when somebody says, oh, they can really draw well, and everybody else in the room goes like, oh, I can't do that, and they stop doing that. So,
and then, but who wants somebody who can draw well? You know, you want somebody who can be creative.
Yeah. Nathan, yeah. He said, where do you think that impulse come from? Well, I genuinely believe it's innate. I just think it's who we are. I think we're people that we're born with these things in our hands, and we're born with these things in our brains, and they want to do things. They want to make things. They want to see things. I mean, one of the reasons that we make all this stuff is just so we can see it.
I do it because I can get all the hot chicks that way.
Sorry.
Worked out pretty well for a couple of years.
But you weren't an artist then.
Yeah, but I said I was.
So there's a reason. I don't know that I have the right answer to that, but I innately know that it's true. That we want to do these things. And you know, the story I always tell is like, we're sitting in this room right now. If you don't think art is important, visual art's important. We're sitting in this room right now. Everything in this room, because we can't see any nature, is designed by human beings. Everything, down this button. Somebody's taking the time to make the decisions about everything. Everything on this. Somebody is designing this. It is huge in our culture. I mean, otherwise, we'd just be sitting on the grass and none of us have any clothes on. Imagine that for a little bit. So we're just sitting around talking. Yes, pretty good. So my point is, like, art is one of the most fundamental things there is. It becomes way before text. It becomes way before, I think, any sort of a lot of spoken language.
Is that why all these people came here tonight? What does this have?
Yeah, I have no idea why they came. I think they thought there was food. I'm not sure.
You know, I think they came to steal our ideas.
Steal our ideas, of course they did.
I mean, that's why I go to the lecture, so I learn something and then steal it from them.
So at Christmas, a couple years ago, Teeth gave me this package.
Wrapped it myself.
Yeah. Proudly wrapped it itself. So what was great about this, I saw this and I just thought it was great. It was a metal container with Lincoln logs in it, which I loved. Immediately made the log. It was a great gift. But I really liked this cutout paper. And I liked it because it was cheap. And I liked the cheap cellophane underneath. Everything was like, it was really right to me. So I just took it to the studio. I just saved it. I didn't throw it away. I thought there was something to it. And of course, it initially was going to be what was going to be on the big window up there, which is now that kind of light bulb thing. But we didn't give up on this idea. So when they built that red wall out there on the other side, this is the tidal wall, there was a blank wall. Of course, we did this like 3 days before the show opened. Well, there's a wall. Got to make some art. So this is our starting point on that wall.
And of course, you know what this is. It's something a child does to make snowflakes out. To fold up the paper and cut it out and unfold it, and you have a snowflake. And so it's very hands-on, very kind of basic activity.
Yeah, the green tape was just there because we actually were just going to do something in the center, so we put the tape up, and the green tape was on the paper, and we just liked this format that was starting to happen, but we never, just like this talk, we never could quite figure out exactly what we wanted to do, so then it became this tree and guns and different kinds of paper, and then it became this, yeah. And then if you go upstairs, you can see what it finally became. So this is, you can see our decision-making process here. I mean, I'm sure for Chris it was painful to watch us doing this over and over again. But all this is cut paper and scotch tape, you know.
Sometimes the process is really painful, you know, it just keeps going on, trying this, trying that. And, you know, one person doesn't like it, and the other person loves it, and then the other person tries something else, and so then, I mean, it's challenging, I think, sometimes, and it's a bit of a tug, you know, back and forth. Hey, set this up. This is great. I don't think so. You know, it's tugging back and forth, but...
You know, working this way, I mean, I'm sure it sounds like we had a lot of fun, and we did have a lot of fun, but I think we both do this because it's a real challenge. It's a real buzz to, like, work like this, and then when you finally get something and you take off, it's like the boat upstairs. We would have never, ever made that boat alone. We wouldn't have gotten to that point. The boat represents this whole other kind of leap for us, and... So it was
worse. We refused to believe we couldn't do it. We just said, yeah, let's make a big old boat.
Yeah.
12 feet high, 25 feet long. Oh, yeah, right.
We had no idea how to construct this. We consulted some of the best exhibition designers in town, Colin Gray, Roland Fortier, Paul Prince, Chris, had them over at the studio, had the model. This is what we want to do. How do we want to build it? guys were great, did all these drawings.
They have so many great ideas.
They have great ideas. And then about a week later, we said no. And we said no to our own ideas. And then we just started buying wood and putting it together. So it's been a thrill. I mean, other ideas we had, like to put all these signs on the wall up there. Because
we wanted to darken the studio so that the boat would glow. So we had to darken the studio where the doors were and the windows.
Because we really like this. And actually, this is an artwork. You can see it's in a gallery, but I don't know if it's a total lift or somebody made it. But it's kind of like this visual information that we're overwhelmed with. My personal favorite on here is the Barragan Nan Chimai. I don't know, is that Vietnamese, the bottom part? It's like an Irish bar. The Irish, that's my people. They're everywhere, you know? It's like, there they are.
It's beautiful.
It's a beautiful thing, yeah. So these are just like initial sketches for ideas. Keith really wanted to have a big pond of water.
I wanted to put a big old swimming pool in the gallery. Yeah. Judy was really happy about that. Hey, Judy, what do you think? 55,000 gallons of water in the studio. It's an idea.
Yeah. And you know, we got one drone in there. You see some drones on this one.
There was sort of the first experiment with how to make that stained glass boat. So this is about 7 feet tall.
We were going to make the whole thing out of twigs. Structurally, it was going to be like...
Because I'm a twig man. I'm a twig man myself.
But you'll notice a couple other things in here that Keith has done in this, is that it's not just all cellophane. Some of those are like food bags. Can you see those throughout there?
Yeah.
Just as another way of transparencies. When you go back up to the gallery and you look at the pajama wall, notice the little pajamas that are clear and they have little cherries. Cherries painted on those. Those are from the inside of cereal boxes. Those are the liners that have been sewed together.
You don't have a smoke, do you?
Yeah, Keith, why don't you have a smoke? Yeah.
And
I don't know, I think this might be the last one. But anyway, this was the drawing.
We're running out of stuff, you better make this one last.
Yeah. This is like, especially for students.
And it's smarted.
It's made out of wood, isn't it?
Twigs, I told you twigs. You don't have to believe it's not really. It's not there. It's not real. We lost one.
I knew it. So we're trying to figure out what to do with the big window. And we started talking about light bulbs and the funny idea that you'd block the light, bring in natural light to make artificial light. And Keith and I had drawn some light bulb things, and then Keith just did this sketch. And this is the whole basis of that whole window. And we tried to follow that kind of flow of those lines. So the sketch probably...
And we had lots of discussions about, taking away from the boat, you know, that translucent, glowing boat, you know, by adding another. And so the boat, I think of as translucent, and these light bulbs, I think of as transparent, because as you can see outside, you can actually see the outside of the window through the little yellow. And so we talked about that, illumination, darkness and lightness. We even talked about movement for a while. I'm sorry.
I couldn't hear you.
Oh, put the damn microphone up there. For a while, I wanted to have the boat flop around, you know, have a motor and kind of... That didn't happen. But anyway.
If you happen to come on campus early in the morning...
Here's an example of reflection.
This happens on the floor, and you can only see it early in the morning. And it's a beautiful thing that we didn't plan at all. And people have said, what are you going to do in the future? I think coloring books. We're going towards the coloring book idea. You know?
Maybe not.
Maybe not.
Yeah.
And that, so... 7:30 already. Does anybody nobody has any questions, right? There's no. Nothing.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.